We are here in Bamenda 3. Bamenda 3 has a population of about 200,000 inhabitants. Bamenda 3 is located 366 kilometers northwest of the Cameroonian capital, Yaoundé. Bamenda is known for its cool climate and hilly environment. Bamenda was subjected to German colonialism in the late 19th century. And evidence of German occupation of Bamenda can be seen in structures like the one I'm standing in front of. Bamenda is the seat of the largest opposition political party in Cameroon, the Social Democratic Front, SDF, and this is the home of its leader, Nijon Frunzi. The SDF was founded in Bamenda at the Liberty Square on May 26, 1990. Bamenda 3 is one of three subdivisional councils which make up the city of Bamenda. It is made up of two villages which includes Nkwen and Banja. Most of its inhabitants are either farmers or petit traders living in huge families. These big families need a lot of water for drinking, cooking, cleaning, and more, like this family. They are happy to have direct access to drinking water. What if they don't?
Sure. This tap for 5 years has not seen any water. You see, we struggle to bring water.
Well, we have to go sometimes right down below the palace. You know, at the low point, the water is sometimes there in the night. We go sometimes at 10 o'clock in the night to carry water and bring. Mm-hmm.
And many compounds are like this, the same, many.
From both water here, we know we get problem for water. We know they get water for this time. We take 1 mile distance before we get water. But for rainy season, water they come. For rainy season, we get water. For dry season, so we know they get water. Water one come, they come for middle night. For 12 o'clock, no, just come. So if you know we come quick, you know we get them.
It comes sometime like around last week then, so we get problem with water around 2 weeks when we get water for you.
We get problem for water, plenty, because water not come. And we suffer plenty. We carry water now from stream.
Well, getting water from the stream affects our health in a way that we can have skin diseases. Because when you get water from the stream to do laundry, you don't boil the water before doing the laundry. And maybe some of the dresses, we don't iron them before wearing, so it can give skin disease.
Yes, it affects our health because the water and bush water and it don't be purified. We just carry and drink. So after some time, we get stomach problem.
Plenty of people are sick for this country because of that kind of water, because of that stream water. Because no, they not do nothing there. All kind of animals pack inside. And from that one, they bring with fever, bring with all kind of sick for stomach. That's why we go carry water very far before we drink.
Yes, we lost because we know they get water, we will not get and so we face difficulty. Like for the time for drink, we need to get water, as we don't get water, so sometimes if we go for curry, then we go plenty. Then as we go sometimes plenty, the water will reduce more that time. Yes.
The fact that water does not flow regularly and we get water from the stream affects our social lives because time. You need enough time to go and carry the water, and that time you need to do other things. Like now, I was supposed to go to the stream to do laundry, and that would take me more time than when I'm in the house doing the laundry with the water.
Formerly, the school had water. It had the Nkwen water. But I think probably because of pressure on the water and because we are a little bit elevated, for the past 2 years, the school has gone without water. To get small water in the school, I had to sink a well, which even sometimes it gets dry. Because the whole neighborhood, it's not only the school that depends on it, the whole neighborhood depends on that well. So sometimes even before we come to school in the morning, the neighborhood would have removed all the water from the well, and we will need to give time for some more water to settle in the well before we can carry. And the fact that the children cannot have potable water to drink also exposes them to all sorts of health hazards. And worse still, we cannot even clean the toilets the way we would like to clean them because of shortage of water.
So until this is realized here, the crisis will go higher and higher.
I'll be 80 years old. For that number of years, first time, we'll be drink from stream. We will dig some special well for stream where we carry water there. For that time, six not in there like now. Those with grandpa then, they will drink from stream. We too been wake up drink from stream, but six not in there like now. There's no six down plenty.
Nkwen Water Project, which now we have the name as Nkwen Water System. In its true sense, it was first founded under the name Scan Water.
This project started in 1988. It was started by the government that saw the need for pipe-borne water for the Nkwen people. The creation was through Scandinavian waters, commonly called Scan Water.
Yeah, this is the Scan Water tank. Was built in the days of 80s. And then the Scan Water gave us water through this tank.
But the source was a well, or call it a borehole, very close to a stream. It did not quite work, but it connected, it linked it to a stream.
Yeah, the engine was pumping out the water from a stream down here. Then after the water came in here, they purify it before it go up there, before they start consuming inside the village.
It was on for about 5 to 10 years, really. That was the Scan Water. But since it was failing us, because there was the Scandinavians had to leave back home and there was nobody to fuel the tank, the engines.
But they try and contribute money for some few, two months, they were unable because the machine can cost more than 500,000 francs a month. So the village can have no money to buy gas. So they're saying the better thing is better, they look their water by gravity. We finally started again to see, but how can we do with all this? We go on top of the hill looking for springs coming out on top of the hill so that we can take gravity, water by gravity.
The present water is taken from a place more than 10 kilometers to this point. And the money was made available by the Nkwen people. And manual labor was done by them.
The stone was carried on head. They carried the stone on head from the palace up to here and sand, cement up to here, far from the palace up to here. Yeah, inside here is stones which have been built with sand, cement, and then they gather all the water, put it inside here. and the water go down and enter the tank. This is the main tank of the water. All from all the catchment, the water come enter here. From here, the water go down the village for use. Yeah.
At that time, when the water was created, it was a successful story. People were happy to have had water flowing.
First time we have been taking this water, the water become plenty. And all men been great that time. But now, it go about some 7 years today, where the water not come again. It comes more, small.
You have seen the distance we struggle to go and get the water, because we know that the water is very good for a human being, and it's a necessity for the people to use the water to avoid the cholera, as we used to hear it all over. When people drink bad water, and then cholera affected. Some have it that you are going around struggling and see the area. So we are preparing to get more water. But there's no money to work and see that the water can satisfy the population of the Nkwen people or the Nkwen funder.
Actually, I grew up here in Nkwen. And in my last visit since 3 years ago, like from 2009, I started observing the water shortages. And what actually struck me to really rethink about this water situation was when I realized that sitting behind the house, I saw like 10 children or more coming to carry water, and they were not living in our neighborhood. They were actually coming from Buffy, that's a nearby quarter. And I remember that when we were growing up, it was not like that. Everybody could carry water from their own taps in their own houses. But now these children had to walk from their own neighborhoods to our own neighborhood to get water. So that really got me thinking about what we can do to remedy the situation.
Many streams in Nkwen have been drying up, mostly due to some human activities. The distance I've just walked used to be the width of the stream. Now, see what's left of it. Examples of some human activities that have been destroying streams in Nkwen are the felling down of raffia palms, like you see behind, the planting of eucalyptus trees, and the cultivation of some farm crops beside streams.
The planting of eucalyptus trees, well, we can't do without, because we are not in the forest zone. It helps us in building our houses, but we have to plant them far away from our water sources. It's very necessary. So we are discouraging people to plant around the water sources, because the eucalyptus drink a lot of water. If you just want an area where it's swampy, you want it to get dry, just plant eucalyptus there, you soon have hard ground. It's not a good tree for around water sources.
So now it's not only important to ask people to stop planting eucalyptus trees around water reserves, but it's also important that we introduce a new species, like an alternative species that they can plant and use for their timber and firewood. And that's going to ease the replacement of eucalyptus with other species that are more environmentally friendly with regards to water.
Cutting the raffia palms is first a bad idea. I think 3 years ago, the traditional council passed a ruling that no cutting of the raffia palm.
But the greatest, the unfortunate situation is that the growth of population, as you have been moving, you see, many people now want to build around here, and they are forced, and the young men too are forcing themselves, their raffia palm bushes, they sell them out to those who want to build houses, they destroy.
In all the valleys where the raffia palms are, there's abundance of water because it has, the place is cool all the time. So without it, the drying up will be gradual. But finally, after some years, there will be no water there. There will be no water there.
So I think it's really important that we preserve these raffia palms and try to even to rehabilitate us, plant back the palms where they have already been destroyed, so that it can help hold the water level, and so that if the water level is high, that means the more water can get into the catchment, and that means more water can flow to the people.
Yeah, I think all of us, the water project and the council, they are working towards one goal, and protecting of this catchment is of obvious necessity. Now, it is something that we have already started it, and we will continue to reinforce this area with water-loving trees in order to protect this shed.
I'm working with the council. I'm the one who is taking care of protecting the catchment, planting trees. Well, we have some water trees, raffia palm trees that we plant so that will make the catchment will always be cool and it bring more water. They will plant trees along the boundaries to protect cows don't go into the catchment. Humans don't go in and fetch wood or cut down the trees. Yes. So fence it round. Yes.
The framework of the partnership between, as you said, and the Bamenda 3 Council, we presented 5 main activities under the project as a solution, because we want to propose a holistic solution. The first activity will be the community outreach, where we're supposed to go out and meet these families and talk to them and make them see how their activities affect the water negatively or positively, hoping that at the end of this sensitized community outreach, they can adopt friendly habits, habits that are friendly to the water that they use.
We were of the opinion that probably this water system or the water shortage can come about as a result of the absence of meters, because you know, the water is not measured, so the people can just open and leave the broken pipes. They may not care to repair because they know they pay nothing, because they only pay a maintenance levy for 5,000 francs for a whole year.
What I want to say is that I'm calling on the population of Bamenda 3 to make sure that at this stage that we are struggling to put improve on the situation of water in Bamenda 3. At the local level, they should also help us to manage the existing structures well, so that to avoid damages and so on, overflow of water somewhere when people will need it. You open the tap, you allow it to flow for the whole night, for the whole day. I think that is wastage. And when you waste it like that, many, many other people will need it elsewhere to use. So it is just to call on the public to make sure that they use the existing supply judiciously, so as to allow others to benefit from the scheme or the source.
And then we have the aspect of capacity building for the water committee staff.
I am not a technician as such, but we do have our technical staff. When we call technical staff, we don't have engineers because this is a rural situation, but we do have plumbers, trained ones, who can intervene in repairs, replace broken pipes, and when once need arises, we go back to our consultants. I've named them the integrated engineering associates, which are found in Bamenda town here. So that is where we hope when we have real problems.
They need to have a little more specialized training, and they don't have to go to the consultants all the time. That is more expensive. So we intend to also assist in capacity building for the water committee staff.
Bamenda 3 is struggling to improve on the water situation. By improving the water situation, mean that we have to increase the supply, increasing the supply of water and also the quality. So we are mobilizing resources to actually get hire more experts in the water domain, and that could give us advice and also technical know-how for us to carry out the work.
Earlier this year, as you said, had confirmation from the ASA program in Germany that we shall be hosting three participants from Germany that will be working with us here for a period of 3 months on these activities that we are proposing with the Bamenda 3 Council. So we are hoping that we will share with them from their knowledge and also from their cultural differences, so that they can explain to us how some of these things have been done in Germany and how we could incorporate them in the way we act here.
The situation of our stream is a preoccupation of the council, because you see, people have that habit of dumping refuse and all these materials that does not decay to the streams. And when you dump this material, you don't know where they will finally end. So it is our preoccupation to begin by sensitizing the public on the necessity of actually collecting the solid waste. And then maybe we look for kind of way that we can start managing it at a local level before thinking about recycling factory and other greater instruments that could better manage the situation. Now, at this stage, the way we manage the waste is we collect the waste from the city and we just have one dump site. We just go and dump it there. That is the way we do it now. We don't have any good instruments to manage it now than to do it that way.
We also have capacity building for the council staff on waste management, because we, from our observations, like from the baseline research, showed us that the poor management of waste also affects the water around. So we intend to build the capacity of the council staff on how they could better manage their waste with the resources that they have. The last activity that is to improve on the current infrastructure of the water committee. You see that the catchments that are in existence are already small, so we want to look at the possibilities of assisting the water community through the council to get a new catchment and also to improve on their installations, their piping.
To have pipes to chain to a community which is miles away is the greatest handicap, and also tanks. The building of a reservoirs to reserve this water.
While going for the catchment or new catchments, we've also gone for new fundings. We've applied through the government again, but there were some openings for that, electricity and water, and Nkwen choose water. So we hopefully think that for the new budget of 2012, maybe, God willing, Nkwen can be considered, so that we can have, we ameliorate the situation, because we really in a desperate need.
Yeah, the government has a policy of ensuring that everybody has access to potable water, and the government has put measures. So it is done in this way. In regions like in the far north, in the grand north, where we don't have water around, like streams or springs, what the government does is every year they give them boreholes. They program boreholes to be dug in many of the areas. And where we cannot have boreholes, they dig them wells. These are equipped wells or equipped boreholes where you have pumps and everything that fetch water. But down south, where we have water, we have streams, we have springs. Every year, the government allocate money for community portable water schemes to be constructed. Like this year in the Northwest, the public investment budget, we had about 300 and something million to construct water in 10 different localities in the Northwest region.
Yeah, just to inform the Water Project Committee, we, at the level of the council, during this budgetary session, we decided to pay more attention to the water situation of the municipality for 2012. So I think 2012, the council will be coming in with more input in order to work together with the Water Project Committee to improve on the water situation.
Okay.